باب الدهن للجمعاتی. الدهن oil, meaning applying oil for the Friday prayer before going to the masjid. So one we learned, taking a bath. The second thing is applying perfume, and now applying oil also. Now this oil is applied on the body, meaning on the skin as well as the hair. Okay, we limit oil to just the hair, but remember that before, oil was used as a moisturizer for the skin, as a styling agent for the hair, and also a glowing or shimmering agent for the skin. Okay, you know, like people use shimmering lotions or like a bronzer or something like that to make the skin shine and glow. So oil was used for the same purpose. Okay, because it does leave the skin shiny. Okay, so adduhni lil jumu'ah, meaning a person should do some zina on the day of Friday. حدثنا آدم قال حدثنا ابن أبي ذئب عن سعيد المقبوري قال أخبرني أبي عن ابن وديعة عن سلمان الفارسي قال قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يغتسل رجل يوم الجمعة. No man takes a bath on Friday, ويتطهر, and he cleans, ما استطاع, whatever he is able to, من طهر, of cleaning, meaning he cleans himself as much as he is able, وَيَدَّهِنُ مِن دُهْنِهِ, and he applies oil from the oil that he has, أَوْ يَمَسُّ مِن طِيبِ بَيْتِهِ, or he puts a touch of the fragrance from his house, طِيب بَيْتِهِ, the fragrance which is present in his house. ثُمَّ يَخْرُجُ, then he goes out, فَلَا يُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ اثْنَيْنِ, meaning he goes out to the masjid, and when he gets there, he does not separate between two people. Meaning he doesn't go and sit between two people, separating them from one another. ثُمَّ يُصَلِّ مَا كُتِبَ لَهُ, and then he performs what is obligatory on him, meaning the Friday prayer. ثُمَّ يُنصِتُ إِذَا تَكَلَّمَ الْإِمَامِ, then he remains silent when the imam is speaking. إِلَّا غُفِرَ لَهُ, except that it is all forgiven for him. What is forgiven for him? مَا بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ الْجُمْعَةِ الْأُخْرَى, what is between then and the previous Jumu'ah, meaning all the sins between that Friday and the previous will be forgiven. So 1 week's sins will be forgiven. Now there are a number of things over here. First of all, يغتسل, غسل, taking غسل on Friday. Secondly, in addition to غسل, يتطهر, he cleans himself also. What does it mean by this, cleans himself? This is مبالغة في التنظيف, that really trying your best to clean your body. So for example, trimming the nails, getting rid of unwanted hair, doing something extra to clean the body. You know, for example, through the week, a person doesn't bother to clean their feet, for instance. But on Friday, when you're taking a bath, you know, give your feet an extra scrub. You know, under, on the nails, between the toes, whatever necessary. Do some extra cleaning also. Right? يَتَطَهَّرُ مَسْتَطَاعَ مِن طُهْرٍ وَيَدَّهِنُ مِن دُهْنِهِ. What does this refer to? Applying oil and then fragrance? This is an indication to zina, that a person should also, you know, adorn themselves for this prayer, meaning when they have to pray, when they're going for the prayer. And when a person will do this, and especially if you notice, مِن طِيبِ بَيْتِهِ, the fragrance of his house. What does it mean by this? From other narrations we learn, the fragrance of his wife. Huh? When is it that a person will have to borrow fragrance from their spouse? When they don't have it at all. Meaning a person doesn't have it himself, so he has to borrow it from his wife. He has to take some from her. Obviously, some fragrances are such that they're okay, they're suitable for both men and women. Some fragrances are only for women, and some fragrances are only for men. But many are neutral. So if he has to take fragrance from his wife, he may also do that, obviously, with her permission. And remember that women's fragrance at that time was such that, because you see, fragrance is carried by something, right? So at that time it was carried by an oil, extract, okay? It had some liquid form. So if you wanted to apply it, you had to put it on your skin directly. We learned that the Prophet ﷺ, he would apply it on his head. Aisha radhiyallahu anha would apply fragrance oil on the head of the Prophet ﷺ. And the women, the fragrance that they would use, they would apply on their skin, was such that it would leave a color also. Okay? It would leave a color on the skin. And it was light. Meaning the fragrance was light, but the color was strong. And this is something that was discouraged for the men. That you're walking with, you know, for example, color on your cheeks, or color on your neck, or color on your head. Because this is like what? Makeup. And who does that? Women do it. Huh? So, but over here we see the importance of applying fragrance, that even if it's light fragrance and it will leave a color, still, at least there should be a mass, a small touch. Okay, don't apply it all over the face, and don't apply it all over the head, and don't apply it all over the skin, but just a touch. So that at least there is a little bit of fragrance when people will meet you. When you will sit next to someone. أو يمس من طيب بيته ثم يخرج. Then when he goes to the masjid, what is the etiquette? That don't sit between two people, separating them. Unless there is a significant gap between the two, and you know, you sit over there in order to fill the gap. That is acceptable. And that is recommended. Then when you see a gap, you should fill it. Instead of sitting at the back. But don't come in between two people and move them away from each other and sit in the middle of them. Why? Why? Because sometimes people go with their friend, you know, with their brother, with their mother. Why? So that they will sit with them. And you're coming and sitting in the middle, separating two friends, separating two brothers. That's not fair. That's not fair. And this shows to us that it's completely fine to prefer to sit with an individual, okay, in a gathering, even in the masjid, to pray with a friend, to pray next to, you know, a sister of yours. There is no harm in that. You understand? Why is there no harm in this? Why is there no harm in this? Tell me. Okay. You feel more comfortable standing next to a person that you know as opposed to someone that you don't know. Okay? Because you're sitting next to them, you are spending time with them. It's a reason, it's an excuse for you to be together. You've spent the entire week away from your sister and you say, okay, we'll meet at this masjid for Jumma. You don't get much time to talk, but at least you're sitting next to each other. Huh? It's a source of comfort because it's a day of gathering, right? You got ready. You went to the masjid, so you want to be with those whom you love. You want to be with them. And also sometimes when you're praying next to a person whom you know how they pray correctly. You know that when they're standing next to you, they will not keep moving their foot away. Rather, they will form the row properly, and you can focus better in the prayer. Okay? So there's nothing wrong in deliberately standing next to a particular person in the prayer. There's nothing wrong with that. It's good to know, because sometimes you wonder, am I doing something wrong? Is it okay? Am I being an extremist in this regard? There's no harm. But sometimes it's also okay to pray on your own, in the sense that praying next to people whom you don't know, because it's also good to interact with other people. One more thing in this hadith, يُصَلِّي مَا كُتِبَ لَهُ. He goes and prays what is wajib on him. What is wajib on the day of Friday? Which prayer is wajib? The Friday prayer. So over here, ma kutiba lahu is referring to the fard, which is the actual Salatul Jumu'ah. And this shows that there is no prayer before the Friday prayer. Unless, obviously, a person is coming and performing the two rak'ah of the masjid, the hiyatul masjid, or the two rak'ah of wudu. But there is no sunnah before the fard of Jumu'ah. So there is no sunnah ratiba before Salatul Jumu'ah. Okay? There is nafl, okay, like tahiyyatul masjid, but after tahiyyatul masjid, you don't have to perform any sunnah. Rather, you pray what is kutiba lahu, and what is that? The two rak'ah with the imam. Inshallah, we'll discuss more when we will study the other abwab. Okay. Also remember that ma kutiba lahu, when a person gets to the masjid, what is prescribed on him? Tahiyyatul masjid, right? Because that should be done before sitting down to listen to the khutbah. Which means that even when the khutbah has begun, then a person will pray the two rak'ah, right? Or if a person gets to the masjid at a time when the sun is at its zenith, which is a time when technically you should not be praying, but can you pray tahiyyatul masjid? Yes, you can. Okay? Why? Because it comes under the category of ما كتب له. Clear? Okay. Then the end of the hadith says, إِلَّا غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ الْجُمُعَةِ الْأُخْرَى. Whoever will do this, then what will happen? His sins will be forgiven. Which sins? Between then and the other Jumu'ah, meaning the previous Jumu'ah. So, the sins of one entire week will be forgiven. Another hadith tells us, which is in Muslim, that الصلوات الخمس والجمعه الى الجمعه كفارات لما بينهن. Five daily prayers and one Friday prayer to the next Friday prayer are all expiations for the sins committed in the intervals between them. So every time a person goes for Friday prayer, each time he goes for Friday prayer, then what will happen? If he goes for two in a row, then the sins that were committed in between will be forgiven. You understand? Two Jumu'ah in a row. If you go once a month, that's a different thing. Jumu'ah ila Jumu'ah. Okay, the previous hadith, we left that out. Bab. حدثنا أبو نعيم قال حدثنا شيبان عن يحيى عن أبي سلمة عن أبي هريرة أن عمر رضي الله عنه بينما هو يخطب يوم الجمعة. Once عمر رضي الله عنه, when he was giving the khutbah on the day of Friday, is دخل رجل, when a man entered, فقال عمر, so عمر said, لما تحتبسون عن الصلاة? Why are you, or what is it that you were kept away? Because of what is it that you kept away from the prayer? Lima, for what reason? تحتبسونَ, you were kept away. عن الصلاة, from the prayer. Meaning, what kept you away from the prayer? How come you're so late? فقال الرجل, so the man said, ما هو إلا سمعت النداء توضأت. It was just that, it was nothing except that I heard the adhan and I performed wudu and I came. فقال, so he said, ألم تسمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, have you not heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say, إذا راح أحدكم إلى الجمعة فليغتسل, that when one of you goes to the masjid, meaning for Jumu'ah prayer, then he should take a bath, meaning why did you not perform your bath? Why did you just come with wudu? This hadith we learned earlier also. And it's emphasizing the same thing, which is the obligation of ghusl on Friday. But obviously the exception is there in the situation where a person is not able to do that due to a shortage of time or unavailability of water.
حدثنا أبو اليماني قال أخبرنا شعيب عن الزهري قال طاووس قلت لابن عباس.
طاووس said, I said to Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه,
ذكروا أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال,
the people have mentioned that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, اغتسلوا يوم الجمعة, take a bath on the day of Friday, واغسلوا رؤوسكم, and wash your heads, وإن لم تكونوا جنبا, even if you are not جنب, meaning don't just wash your body, but take a complete bath, including your head, وأصيبوا من الطيب, and also apply some fragrance. أصيبوا literally means make to reach, meaning apply. من الطيب, from the طيب, meaning some fragrance. قال ابن عباس, ابن عباس said, أما الغسل فنعم. As for غسل, of course, meaning that is mandatory. وأما الطيب فلا أدري. But as for fragrance, I don't know. Meaning, I don't know if it's obligatory.
حدثنا إبراهيم بن موسى قال أخبرنا هشام أن ابن جريج أخبرهم قال أخبرني إبراهيم بن ميسرة عن طاووس عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أنه ذكر قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في الغسل يوم الجمعة.
That he mentioned the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about ghusl, taking a bath on the day of Friday. فقلت لابن عباس أيمس طيبا. So he said that I said to Ibn Abbas, should a person also apply طيب أو دهنا or oil, fragrance or oil, in كان عند أهلي, if there is some in his household with his family, meaning with his wife. فقال, so he said, لا أعلمه, I don't know that, meaning I don't know if it's فرض. Look at the care that the Sahaba took when they spoke about what was fard and what was not. Imagine Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He is saying, I do not know. I do not know if it's fard or not. Because he did not know. Because ghusl, there were so many instances, so many statements that clarified that it was mandatory. But fragrance, perhaps there were less. And this is why Ibn Abbas was not sure if it was obligatory or not. But the fact that there was a possibility that it could be mandatory, what does it show? That it's definitely